This morning, I'd like to speak to you about contested ground and really contending for the vision. And so a lot of think what Vicki said this morning is going to go right alongside with what I'm going to mention this morning. Because this, in our life, we have to contend for victory. Amen? And so one item that I've also always noticed is there are times whenever we get saved and we get in the church and we think everything is supposed to be easy. And it can be disappointing when it's not. It is not. It is a fight. You have to wrestle for something. And I'd like to just tell you today that God uses those contending times to transform you. And so if you want to be transformed, and if you want to be stronger, and if you want to be better, prepare to engage for the victory. Amen? It's not going to be given to you. It's not. Any area of your life. In fact, this morning, I'll give you 5 areas that you're going to have to contend. Brother Mark, why not give me 2 areas or 1.5? No, there are 5 distinct areas throughout Scripture where you have got to contend. You're going to wrestle. But guess what? You have the grace of God on your side for victory. So your victory is absolute. Your victory is already guaranteed in the cross of Christ. Amen? But you have to contend. You have to fight. Because I preached a message, I forget the name of it, but it was about crossing over. And when Jesus told his disciples at the Lake Galilee, let's go to the other side, when they get halfway across, the storm hits. And Jesus did not tell his disciples, hey, a storm's coming. Get in the boat. There's a storm. We're all going to be fine. What did he do? He said, get in the boat. Let's go to the other side. He fell asleep, right? And the storm came, and the ship began to sink, and so forth, so on. And what I'd like to make a point of reference this morning is that the disciples' prerogative was to go from A to B in the most quick, efficient, and best way possible. We do not like to be inconvenienced. Amen? I mean, how many of you have those momentary lapses of road rage? You know? Many of you may have seen on Facebook my crying baby because my inner child was breaking in Chicago. I had not slept for 48 hours and got stuck in Chicago for 18 of those 48 hours. And I'm three grown men on a business trip. We're doing great. Me, Sean, and Ron. That sounds like a joke, but it's not. And we get in there, and none of us lost our religion. That's the best way you can put it. But it was very hard. But anyway, I'll preach that message later. If you would go with me to Ephesians chapter 6. Again, convenience was the point. Jesus's prerogative in going to the other side was not about convenience. It was about transformation. So when he told the disciples to go to the other side, the destination was sure. But let me tell you, there were 2 trips happening, the one Jesus had them on and the one they thought they were on. Amen? Because his prerogative is for transformation. Our prerogative at times is to say, make life as easy as possible. And praying and going to God and just asking God to do something is not the same thing as contending for something. And so we'll talk about warfare. I'm not going to get over too much into strategy and get over into all of the spiritual warfare aspects. I would love to, you know, teach a 6-month series on it, but it would take about that long to get there. So I'm just going to touch on the grounds of contending, and then I'll make a difference between wrestling and fighting. There's a difference there. So in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12 is a very powerful scripture that lets us know that we are wrestling. And so it says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, and against rulers of darkness of this world, and against spiritual wickedness in high places. Just underline the word wrestling. because it doesn't say I'm fighting. Now, it says we wrestle not against flesh and blood, so you're not wrestling with your neighbor there, but it says you still have to wrestle. So there is a wrestling. But he's speaking here in a form of a sport. At this time, wrestling was an Olympic sport under the Romans. That's how we get all of that. They understood it has rules of engagement. You've got a strategy. You've got to prepare for it. You have to train for it. Are you going to get beat? Is that right? How many of you ever wrestled? There's a difference between wrestling on the mat right there to win and a difference between a street fight or just a brawl. Amen. Come on this morning. Y'all with me this morning? Amen. So Jesus did not tell you to get in a big old brawl. He said you're going to wrestle. There's going to be rules of engagement. Everything is ordered by God. You're not going to get on the enemy's turf, out in his stuff. He does not have an advantage over you, but you have to be exercised in the giftings, and you have to wrestle him to win. So a fight, a wrestling has strategy. Say strategy. It's not emotionally driven. You don't hate your opponent when you're wrestling. You're there to win. Right? Now, if you get into a fight, the purpose of wrestling is to win, to achieve your goal. If you get into a fight, the goal there is an emotional release. Vengeance, anger. Ever seen somebody ever been angry? Has anybody in this room ever been angry? How many of you have ever punched anything or anyone? Okay. Hey, we're getting real this morning. I'm from Virginia, people, now. Anyway. I went to Starbucks the other day. I love Starbucks. Starbucks loves me. I do. I love Starbucks. And so I got a girl there that waits on me all the time, and she is hilarious, and I just love her. She's great. And so I come in there, and his name's Tamika. So Tamika's come in. She got the same name. And so she comes in there, and she's got a thing, but she has a cast on. And this has this arm, these fingers in a cast. And I said, what happened? And she didn't want to tell me. Uh-oh, that's what I said. And, you know, and the nice thing to do would have been to just look and realize and move on. However, because I was in line, I kept on asking her. I said, well, what happened? It's like she said, I got mad, I hit the wall. Next time, I'm going to hit him. I said, all right, that's good. That's good stuff right there. You know your strategy. That's what I told her. Now, if you're going to, the enemy likes to get you so mad that you get into a fight. But fighting does not require your head. It doesn't require anything of God. It doesn't take intercession. It just to get in there, brawl around because you're mad about something. And people who operate that way are bait for Satan for witchcraft. That's just that is the root of witchcraft. It's darkness and selfish emotion. And so when they get mad, then they have all that darkness comes in. The enemy's right there. They think they're doing the will of God. They're doing the work of the devil. And boom, it's a big day. God did not call you to be operating that way. He called you to soberly thinking, not operated by hate and vengeance and all those evil desires. You're supposed to walk with a sober mind, vigilant, but to win. And if you're going to win, you're going to wrestle. And you're going to wrestle in every area of life. Let me give you one more basis, and we're going to move into the five areas. The original sin is pervasive. And that's what we wrestle with. Ever had a virus on your computer? Ever had a virus on your body? All right, out of the way. A virus is not alive. You know, bacteria, you can't take antibiotics and get rid of a virus. Your body has to actually assimilate the virus into your genetic code. And then by way, it reverses it. but it has to assimilate it. If it's a bacterial infection or so forth, then you can do antibiotics and treatments and so forth. But a virus is it's an amazing item. It literally is, at the molecular level, has a particular shape that it fits exactly into a live cell, even though it's not alive. Once it's in there, it can replicate itself, burst out, and infect other cells. It's not alive. You can't kill it. But it is an evil little thing. And that's how the enemy works. Well, in Genesis chapter 1, 2, and 3, and we get into the fall, creation, and so forth, the original sin is like a virus that was released into all of creation, and it distorted everything. Now, God created this perfect world, this perfect humanity. But the original sin distorts all of it, and that's what you're wrestling with, the distortion. So the five areas, you're going to wrestle with creation. And then we'll go by and identify those items. You're going to wrestle with creation. It's going to wrestle with you. That's in Genesis chapter 3. So the world outside, the world, is going to wrestle with you. The ground is going to wrestle with you. It is. Now, once you get it going, you're doing good, though. This is the whole thing about contending. I could give you an example of just having your yard manicured. Go home, just do an exercise. Do not mow or tinker with your yard for 6 months. Don't do it. Don't do anything. Don't mow it. Don't maintenance your house. Don't maintenance it. Don't clean it. 6 months. And every housewife says amen. Don't do laundry. Don't do anything. And let me tell you what's going to happen. It's going to decay. Your yard is going to be a jungle. Is that right? And then, so if you maintenance your yard, and now you're wrestling with it. If you're maintenancing it every week, every other week, mowing it, keeping up, if you're repairing your house, it stays alive. But if you let it go, how much more exponential effort does it take to fix 6 months overnight? You can't do it. Well, warfare and contending is the same way as maintenancing. So creation is going to wrestle with you. The enemy is going to wrestle with you, and you're going to have to wrestle the enemy. That's principalities, powers, mights, and dominions. So creation, don't think that Jesus is going to mow your yard. You know? Every 10 years, your genetics copies itself. You know that? I saw that on the Science Channel. Every 10 years, your DNA literally replaces every part of your body, every 10 years. But it's the same thing with putting a picture in a copy machine and making a copy and then making a copy of the copy every 10 years. That's why we age and we distort. I'm on my fourth copy. Jesus. So I'm wrestling. We wrestle with creation. We wrestle with the enemy. Guess what? You're going to wrestle with God. Somebody may not teach that, but you are. You're going to wrestle with God. He's going to wrestle with you, right? Because we think we know right, but we don't have a clue. One of the keys to spiritual warfare, not spiritual fighting. If y'all walk away with anything from this service this morning, don't go into spiritual fighting. You do spiritual warfare. One has strategy. You're not emotionally involved in it. It's not, you're not trying to operate through base emotions. If you think you're going to raise base emotions and not and have a spiritual victory through fleshly desires, you just crossed a line. So the enemy, creation, you're going to wrestle with God. You're going to wrestle with the world. That's the people. The world's going to hate you. That's what Jesus said, and we'll go on those scriptures. The world's going to hate you, right? Finally, the fifth, you are going to wrestle with yourself. You're going to contend with yourself, right? So creation, the enemy, God, the world, and yourself. Now, if we are going to have this understanding and win, we're going to have to get a strategy, and that's where God comes into play. So if you would, we went to Ephesians, so we're establishing wrestling. The difference between wrestling and fighting, we're not here to fight something. We're here to what? To wrestle something. We're going for victory, not for an emotional release. Amen? Let me give you a cautionary note here on John chapter 10, verse 10. John 10:10. The purpose of wrestling is to transform me. It puts me in a place of resistance that I'm transformed. But there's a real price in this. I like to work out. I like to lift weights. And part of it is just an escape. You get away and you're doing something productive with your time instead of sitting on a couch and eating chips. I could do that. You know, you can sit down, put Netflix on, go through for a whole season in one day and eat through two bags of chips and a thing of ice cream. I did sit down. Easton got braces, and he can't have sugar ice cream, right? So they had this ice cream that has 3 grams of sugar. So I started, I sat down, and I was watching, I think it was Arrow on Netflix or whatever. So I was all engrossed in the whole season. By the end, or by many episodes in, I had eaten that entire tub of 3 gram ice cream. I did not even know it was so good. It was just like, it was a repetitive motion. And my brain, I was watching TV. I was eating the whole time. And Deidre came home and said, "Where's the ice cream at?" What do you say? I wrestled with it. That's what you say. And John 10:10, and again, going back to working out, when I was 25 years old, I weighed 125 pounds. I weigh 150 pounds now. I couldn't bench my own body weight. Now I can do 100 pounds over my body weight. But it took time. And so when I get in the gym and everything's perfectly laid out, I'm 150 pounds laying across that bench. I've got 240 pounds over my chest. I'm in a life-threatening situation. You drop that and it's going to crush something somewhere. I'm not going to walk right for a week, all right? More than a week, right? Why would I put myself in that situation? A controlled situation. Why? It changes my body. Right, I would never be able to lift if I was not willing to contend with the weights. Now, do I get angry at the weights? No. Do I yell at the weights? No. Do I hate the process? No. God designed your body to work a certain way. And if you give it the right environment, it produces something very unique. And what I'm saying to you is God will cause you to contend in creation. He'll cause you to contend with him. But it's no different than the resistance that I face in the gym that makes me stronger. Every time you wrestle, every time you contend, you are better. Every time you fight, you are weakened. Do not think you are going to get in a fist fight and come out better on the next day. And people don't think people go to church and don't have fist fights. It's just all in the spirit, baby. But your blood is still real. I won't give any testimonials on that. I will just tell you, I had to learn not to fight, and the enemy baits you in. So John 10:10, I want you to let you know it is real. John 10:10. I may have given you the wrong scripture. No, that's right. John 10:10. The thief cometh not but to kill, to steal, and to destroy. Christ said, "I have come that you might have life, and that life more abundantly." When you are wrestling and contending with the enemy, I want you to know something. It is death ground. That is a military term. It is called death ground. That means either you live or you die on that ground. Don't ever think that you are going to, it's a game. Do not. Do not think you can mess around with the enemy and not win. You have to win. You have to win correctly. The scripture is very clear. The power of the Holy Spirit, humility, God will guide you and protect you, all these things. But when you're in a war, you're in a war. Don't half do it. Intercession, fasting, knowing scripture, all these things are transformative elements that allow you to become victorious on the battlefield. God has performed, has given you the ability. This is not something that is uncommon to you. Victory is where you are supposed to be. The same way, again, use the gym analogy for my sake. When I go in there, it's not causing my body to do something that it's not meant to do. It's unlocking what it already has, its own potential. Amen? When you engage, it's not as if when you're fighting against creation, when you're wrestling with God, all these things, it's going to unlock in you the potential that's already there. Don't fear it. Don't think that if I wrestle, I can lose. Just take it serious. Because the enemy is very serious about it. The enemy comes for three reasons. Don't think you can negotiate with him. Don't think that you can change his mind. He has three reasons, three purposes, and he's going to do his best to accomplish them. At the end of the day, we ask the question, God, why? If I'm saved and born again, why do I have to wrestle? And it is the process by which that we take dominance, that we take governing ability. Dominion is the correct term, excuse me. And that term, dominion, is to govern over. So when we go back to Genesis and God says, I've given you dominion over the earth and all of these things, we have to, because of the fall, we have to wrestle to retake dominion. But you're meant to have dominion. All right? So over the enemy, number one, you're going to wrestle with the enemy. I wanted to add that in John 10:10 because I want you to know something. You cannot fight the enemy on his ground. And if he baits you into conflict and strife, James 3:16 says where strife is, every evil work abounds. Please know something. If you have strife, and the enemy will first want you to open up conflict, hurt feelings, to hurt someone. Someone will actually, the enemy will call someone to attack you, and in that attack, it'll be personal. When it's personal, it opens up hurt feelings and offense, and that offense becomes strife. That's the bait of the enemy. I mean, it is not about, wrestling is about partnering with God. He's your coach. He's not going to let you get on the mat and not be ready for it. He's going to train you. But he's your coach, and he'll be screaming out on the sidelines exactly what you need to do. Amen? But all because he's your coach doesn't mean you have to forego the ring. Because his goal is to transform you. Our goal is just to get through life and make it to glory and have our cabin on the side of heaven, glory, whatever. He calls you to rule and reign. He causes you to be a kingdom of priests. Isn't that powerful? You see, it's an honor to work with him, and he'll never be satisfied until he takes you and transforms you into what he called you to be. So the enemy, take him serious, but the Lord has already removed his abilities, but you still have to contend. Creation is in Genesis chapter 3, verse 16 through 19. I'm just going to give it to you. I'm not going to go back and read to it. But after the fall, we understand that childbirth became labor, and then for Adam, God said the earth itself, the ground, the self is going to work against you. Now, Andy's a farmer. That means his entire industry and so forth that he has is all about wrestling with that. And you're going to see it in your crops. You're going to have crop failures and so forth. But at the same time, even though Andy has to wrestle with it, once you have figured it out, you rule over it. And that's very powerful. The entire agricultural industry is based on the fact that we have the God-given ability to govern over. And so when you're feeding no telling how many millions of people, you know, that come through the food from Louisiana is feeding the world. America, the breadbasket of America feeds the world. And It is amazing what we have done. In fact, in the early 1920s, there were scientists saying that we would not have enough food in the world to feed the population. But because of technological breakthrough with all these new inventions, we're feeding more people now than they even thought we could. It's amazing. But it's dominion. So every time you go to work and in what you do, remember, God's given you dominion. This is it's a spiritual prize. It's a spiritual rule that you're operating out of. When you're coming to church, you're learning how to have spiritual dominion. So creation. Genesis chapter 32, you're going to have to wrestle with God. And he's going to wrestle with you. And I love the passage. And some say, you know, God, why are you messing with me? He's not. He's transforming you. I can take you from Genesis to Revelations and show you why everything's a wrestling match. And it's all about your transformation, your betterment. Now, I will tell you that you have to do it consistently. That is the key to consistency is the key. So you have to do it right. You have to learn. You have to educate yourself, right? Or you end up working against yourself. So you can learn a lot about Scripture and a lot about how to do hermeneutics. I know they're doing the class on Sunday nights. You can learn a lot. You can do a lot of research. But if you have not yet submitted your will to God, and then you're trying to, you know, God does not control nor manipulate. He influences and he leads. There's two different things. How many of you have raised your children? You got kids in the house, right? Have you ever had times that you have spoken to them, told them not to make a certain decision, but you could not make them make the right choice and they still had to do it? You know how it made you feel? It hurts, doesn't it? Right? But when your child's able to go through that learning process, they mature and grow and you're able to reconnect and learn from it. Am I correct? Amen? That's how God is. God's not going to stop us from making mistakes. But he's always there for us, and he takes every opportunity to make us better. Amen. Wrestling with God is an imperative. This is where, in Genesis chapter 32, is when Jacob was wrestling with the angel. It says angel. I say it's Jesus himself. I really do. I think Jesus is so personal. In Genesis chapter 2, when God comes down and makes man out of the dust of the earth, please know something. God spoke everything else in creation. He spoke everything, but he put his hand on you. The touch of the divine is on you. This is powerful. So all the birds, all the fish, the stars, the planets, everything, he spoke. But he personally came down and put his hands on you and breathed on you, and man became a living soul. That's what makes you different than every other creation on the face of the earth that was spoken. You were formed. So it's personal for God. You're his prized possession. Amen. But he also teaches us and chastises like we would our own children. He tells you, don't do that. Don't do that. But when you do it, we're going to learn together. He doesn't throw you away. Oh, well, I failed you. Well, we all fail God. We all fall short of the glory of God. Amen. But God also knows that we have an enemy, that there is the original sin that wrestles against us every day, every night, and in every way. And he knows that we are frail people. But he's touched me. Every day, you may make a mistake. You may feel like you're going under, like you're about to lose your mind. You can stand there for a moment and just say, you spoke everything else, but you touched me. I bear his mark. I would like to give you some background in Genesis chapter 32. Jacob's name was being transitioned to Israel, transformed. Jacob was a supplanter. He was a deceiver. He was the... the kid in the bunch or the individual in the family that could make money but was a con artist. He'd have been good for a Ponzi scheme or something. Now, he was a smart guy, a successful guy, but he would use deception to get victory. So we know he learned it from his mama. It's true. Even though they had a prophecy, it was prophesied that the second born would rule over the family, blah, 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 blah. But instead of trusting the Lord, they waited till the old man got so old he couldn't see, and then she put fur on his arm because Esau was furry. Right? Need a little landscaping, manscaping. But he was furry. And then so he deceived him, going there and stole the blessing. Why? Not because the blessing would not have come to him in God's way or God's time, but they didn't trust God enough to say, I trust you at your word. How many times we get a word from God and think we have to fill it, we have to fulfill it? The moment you use your own devices, your own intellect to achieve the will of God, you just crossed over into something. You've got a curse coming. Deception. Well, at this point, he had a couple wives, you know, and a bunch of kids, and he divided his family because he knew Esau was coming to kill him. So he divides them. Why? God told him to go home. He had the promise on him and the blessing. He didn't have to be a deceiver, but at his heart, he was a deceiver. So he divided his family, so if Esau killed half of them, he'd still have the other one. Love you. Now, baby, you're going to take these kids, and you're going to go over here. Baby, you're going to take these kids, you're going over here. Now, if you get killed, I'm going to hold her. That is some drama. That is drama. But deception was going to cost him the promise. Let me tell you, deception, Jacob could never inherit the promise, because you cannot live in the world system and inherit God's calling on your life. You cannot, if you're called of God and you want to walk in the ways of God and you want God's favor on your business, on your family, you cannot act and walk like the world. The world uses deception and manipulation and lies. The enemy operates that way. The world has this conniving where hates and going to hate you to your face and behind your back, talk about you and hug you on the next day and curse you. And that's how the world works. God will never honor that. So you better, if that's how you work and that's how you operate, where you stirring strife around one here and the other, you got to change. You need deliverance. And God's going to wrestle with you. You can never have the promise and the anointing of God on your life when you're operating like the devil. Amen. I'm here for one day so I can say all those things. So why did God separate Jacob and fight with him? Because if he was ever going to be the man to walk in the calling of God upon his life, he had to change. But the identification of Jacob, of deceiver, was so deep inside of him. It was such a part and woven into his personality that it required God himself to come down and wrestle with him until he hit him in the thigh. He came over and he said, cleave to me. Why did he do that? Why did Jacob hold on to God's leg and walk with him and not let him go? Because he knew Esau was coming. At daybreak, Esau was coming, a warrior. Jacob, a mama's boy, deceiver. Jacob was not a fighter. Esau was the warrior on the horse with the bow and arrow, could shoot and kill something from the horse galloping down the thing. Jacob was at home cooking with mama. He could decorate your house, not build you a house. Amen? Okay. So when he got here, when you've got Jacob being weaker in that way, he feared his brother. He knew that a toe-to-toe fight, I can't beat you. And then here comes God going to take his hip out of joint, and now he's dragging a bum leg, and here comes Esau. He can't run. He can't hide. He can't deceive. He can't fight. He can do nothing. He was helpless. He had divided his wives and his family. If some of them got killed, he was going to make it. But right now, he wasn't going to make it. And he yelled out to God and said, God, I will not let you go until you bless me. And what does God say to him? No longer are you, I have broken you. I have gotten down to the heart of you. You've held on to deceiver. I've blessed you. I've prophesied to you. I've showed you dreams and visions. But you never let me get down deep in the core of who you are. You never really gave me you. But now I've got you, and I say no longer deceiver. I'm plucking it up by the roots. You're now Israel. You're my king. You're my prince. And here's my anointing. Whoo! It's powerful. Why do we wrestle? Because God loves you, and he will not suffer you to take a lower road. You can't do it in the arm of the flesh. But you have to surrender. But you know you don't surrender willingly. The flesh is something. When you're wrestling you, it's easier to kill, you know, or fight others. But I like me. Come on, really? So we make excuses for ourselves. We don't admit certain things about ourselves. Right? But God loves us so much that he'll even wrestle with us for our own excuses. And so you have to trust him. I love the song that Sandy sang. In here about, you know, when that mountain didn't move and that you didn't divide that water. You know, we want God to move the mountain. We want God to, but maybe his prerogative isn't to make your path easy. Maybe he wants to change you. So then you have to discover, you know, oh God, I need a new job. I'm on this job. This job is terrible, but I have no way out. Maybe his prerogative is a little bit different than yours is, right? His prerogative is transformation to make you stronger. When I work out the next day, the day after you work out and the 2 days after that, you are so sore you can barely get out of bed. Has anybody ever worked out in an exercise? All right, you know what I'm talking about then. But you know that on that second day and third day you start getting better, but you hurt. I mean, it's a for real hurt. But it feels so good. Because you know you're getting stronger. So don't worry about wrestling with God. Don't worry about wrestling with yourself and so forth. You'll work it out. Just don't make excuses not to get in the ring. Amen? So you're wrestling with God there, wrestling with the world. John chapter 16, verse 33 is a scripture where Jesus was talking to his disciples. And he said, these things I've spoken unto you, that you may have peace. In the world you're going to have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. World is people, it's the world system. There is a system out there. And it's very demonic, it's corrupt. It is. It's about people staying in power. I could give you statistics, but no need. It's a shame at times to see those that are hungry in the world whenever we throw food away. Dumpsters full. I commend those who do different kind of innovative items. I know in Lynchburg and other cities, in Tulsa, I work to feed the homeless and the poor. We would go also sit and just minister to those that were HIV positive at their home. They had a home there. And all their families would reject them. Nobody. They'd lose everything, all the relationship, and they would go to these homes just to die. And we'd go just have lunch with them, and it meant everything. But feeding people, there are organizations that go around cities and they go to restaurants that any food that they have left over the night before, they give it to them, and then they do a soup kitchen, and then the next day they distribute that food to those that are in need. If Monroe doesn't have one, you need to think about doing that. Because you have all this food that's thrown away in the dumpsters. That's inexcusable. And so there's so much that we have, but the world has a system, and when you're saved, you are delivered from that system. And even though there is a measure of success in the world, there is no peace. They're always fighting with themselves. They're always trying to get one more thing. They're trying to climb the ladder by stepping on other people. There's lies and there's manipulation. You can never get into that world. You have to trust that God's way is the better way. And his anointing. So you don't have to self-promote. In fact, I enjoy being underestimated. If I'm underestimated, my opponent does not prepare for me. So it just makes my job a little easier. So I prefer to be underestimated. Let me tell you one key in contending in spiritual warfare. First key is called humility. If you are an arrogant individual and you're prideful and you like to show that I beat them, I told them, you know, if you like that, I'm talking about, you're boasting. And if you're boasting about how successful you are in your fights and so forth, if you're boasting about with arrogance and pride, it's going to catch up to you. Humility is the first key to successful. That means that if God gives you victory privately and you never tell anyone, it's okay. Amen? I stand here this morning and have years. I have battle scars. They're covered up with this suit. I can show you bullet holes. I can show you knives in the back. I can show you betrayal. I can show you lies. I can show you where witchcraft has been put against me. I can show you time and time and time again. Why can I stand up here behind this pulpit and have some sense of joy and laughter and love God and increase and better today? I'm stronger today. And why can I not resent those things? Because God has saved me. Amen? I mean, I know people who are not in church and they have to fight hell anyway. At least I have an answer. Amen? Don't think if you're going to leave the church. I mean, the world's crazy. So you're going to wrestle with the world. Oneself. Let's go to Romans. So you wrestle with God, wrestle oneself. Roman, this is a very difficult scripture to read. It's one they used to make us read in Romans 7. It's a very hard passage to read through it preaching, so I'm not going to go through all of it. It's a tongue twister. It can be. They used to make us read it in class, in one of our theology classes. And you had to read really fast. And anyway. But Romans chapter 7, verse 14 through 25, I can read a few verses and you'll get the gist of it, and then we'll go to 24. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. Oh, that's pretty powerful, right? The law is spiritual, but I am carnal, and I've been sold under the original sin. What he's saying here is that because of Adam's choices, because Adam's sin was multiplied, but through the last Adam, Jesus Christ, grace abounds more. Amen. So even one that caused so much death, how much more life is going to come through Jesus? Amen. What he's saying, he said, here's the reality here. The law that I operate, the things that I see of God, they're spiritual. They're real. But I was sold under sin because of Adam. It's in me. It is. I mean, you can be saved this morning, get up and eat your Cheerios, come to church, worship Jesus, and then one thing, you get one phone call, one text, one something, you leave that door, and all of a sudden some sin gonna come out. Right? And you just had your hands raised for hours, you just were blessing, and Brother Mark prayed for me, and I got, woo, Jesus. Amen. And then go out there, and then somebody, you know, didn't make your steak right at lunch, or the waiter dropped the coffee on you or something, and blah, 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 blah. It is true. Because why? It's in here. And we are damaged products. There should be a recall on me. I'm going to be nice. There are a lot of safety hazards that are in us. God has the answer. His grace is sufficient for me. Okay, so it says in verse 15, "For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, I do." So, if then I do that which I would not, and I consent unto the law, which is good, now then there's no more that I do it, but sin that dwells within me. Oh, so we're getting down into all the kind of stuff. He's saying, I know what I'm supposed to do. I've got the books. I went to the conference. That preacher prayed for me. I whatever, 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 whatever. I did everything, but it's still in me. I still get angry. I still have a temper. I still feel like this. Now, I personally really don't have a temper issue. That wasn't a confession. When something really bad happens or really gets where I get angry, I see it. And I get quiet. That's my response. But then when I do respond, it's beautiful. it's like a poem. So it may take me 2 days. it's coming. In all honesty, the first thing that I do when someone, especially, you know, Sean and I, you know, we strategize. We face a lot of difficulties. We're being very blessed now. We have the full online government program, full criminal justice program, undergrad, master's degree in criminal justice, master's in public policy, a full pre-law program. And we've got 7,000 students. We've got all kinds. It is amazing, but it's a lot of stuff. And when you're at that level coordinating with Sean on how to make all that work right, and then you've got the enemy tries to get involved, because we're raising up champions for Christ. Every student that comes through there, we have one-third of the program is worldview integration. They're going to hear about Jesus. What does the Word of God say about criminal justice? Now, that's powerful. So we're looking right now about how to really change the criminal justice. So you fight the devil a lot. And you strategize. And when I get caught in the middle of the enemy's accusation or something that's coming, I have to see it so that I can respond, not react. So that's why I do that. And I would ask you to use a Webster's dictionary, look up the word react, look up the word respond, and tell me which one you do. And reaction is a negative. A response is thoughtful. A reaction is, I get slapped, I slap back. It's just like, poop, poop. Yeah, yeah. You know, it's like you did something. It's cause you doing something, you did something. No, you just made it worse. So, but a response always furthers your strategic goal. Now, all because somebody hits me doesn't mean, whether it be physically, I don't know about physical, but anyway. Well, regardless if you get hit in a situation, you need to ask yourself, when I respond to this, is it going to get me closer to my goal? And then if you ask that, if you can say yes on that question, and you submit to the Lord with humility, Lord, I need to, this is happening, and I need to understand how to advance. I need to respond. Holy Spirit, please, you know, help me, guide me. I'm not going to do anything until I've submitted to you, Lord. But I need to respond to this situation, not react to this situation. Sometimes a reaction is to someone attacks you, insults you, you insult back. A response can be just to ignore it. The best thing to do is just ignore it and move on. Don't let it get in here. Amen? So when we read through this process in verse 24, it says, O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death? And the answer is Jesus Christ. Amen? Say his grace is sufficient for me. Now, I'm gonna give you one more scripture. How am I doing on time? I don't have a time in my head. I'm good. We're good. Are y'all okay with me continuing a few more minutes? In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7 through 10, it's where Paul says, I've got this buffeting attack from the devil. I've prayed 3 times for God to take it away. And God's response is, my grace is sufficient for thee. Amen? Because why? He said that God was using this buffeting. It's not up there. I'll go to it here. He says, lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of revelation. There was given to me a thorn in my flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. Remember, God's perfect. Amen. He knows. This is Paul, not the most humble guy in the world. He's not. He said, I'm a Jew of Jew. I'm from the best stock. I know it better than you do. But I think I count all of this as dung. But to know Jesus. But he still had to list it, didn't he? I'm just saying. He gave you his pedigree to let you know just how much he was sacrificing. It's true. I mean, Paul was the guy that gets put in your face in public. And I have no problem. I don't know if me and Paul would be friends or not. If he was here today, I'd love Paul. You have to love all personality types. But he was the kind of guy that if you preached something that he didn't like, he would be the first one at the podium saying, you're wrong. Okay. There's a lot of those in the world, right? And I'd be looking at Paul saying, you do it. And he'd be like, fine. See, we're having a fight. I'm having a fight with Paul right now. But Paul said, because I've had all this revelation, I've gone to glory. I've actually walked heavenly streets and come back. I mean, this guy's, I guess that's pretty big for bragging rights. Because he got all that, the price he had to pay was to have a thorn in his side to let him know, even though you've done all of this, you're still human. You're still human. So don't think because that you have a great revelation on Sunday that you don't have to fight hell on Monday. But also don't think because you fight hell on Monday that you lost what you got on Sunday. Amen? You see, the fact that Paul went to heaven and walked the streets of gold was not discounted because he had a thorn in his side. Oh, if I just can't get this out. No, it's keeping you humble. But you're still walking the streets of gold. You're still calling upon his name. You're still seeing miracles of God's deliverance. Amen? All because you fight hell doesn't mean you are not a victorious exactly where God's got you. That's in Crossed, Arkansas. That's at your house. That's with your family. That's in every area of your life. Don't think because you have an area of weakness that keeps you humble that it literally means you're not victorious with God. And he got in Paul prays. And God says, my grace is sufficient. What does the word grace mean? Unmerited favor. That's so two-dimensional. How many of y'all like to, would you like to see something two-dimensional on TV or there in person? Well, I want to see it in person. Do I want to watch bass fishing on TV or do I want to go bass fishing? Do I want to read about it or do I want to experience it? Right? Okay. So you hear this definition called grace. Unmerited favor. It means that Jesus Christ himself came to this earth because he loved you. And he, according to Daniel, was the eternal judge, judged himself. His body was broken. He was beaten. He wrestled against sin unto bleeding. Hebrews chapter 12 and 13, very clear. He wrestled against sin until he bled. He cried blood. So why? So you would not have to wrestle against that until you bled. Why is it that the blood of goats and the blood of lambs and the blood of Abel does not cry out as good of things as the blood of Jesus? Because he is our eternal God. And he left the comfort of glory to come down and do something that you and I could never have won. We could never have beaten the pervasive original sin. But when Jesus Christ came, died upon the cross, paid that price, his body was broken and beaten for you and I. Then whenever we call out to him and he applies his grace, he's applying the full measure of his victory for your life. So grace is not just unmerited favor. It is the everything about the cross wrapped up into one blessing that he says, I paid it, I've done it, you're not going to die because I did die. Amen. Satan cannot kill you because he killed me. He sacrificed his life. He let the enemy kill him, raised on the third day, that you and I can have life today. So every time that you say, when you're wrestling with creation and your job is hard and you don't want to go to work and you don't know what to do and you're wrestling with the world system, my grace is sufficient for thee. When you are wrestling with your family, coworkers, and people, and there are lies and dysfunctions that are going on, my grace is sufficient for thee. When you wrestle with God, you do not know how, you don't know what he wants from you. Ever been there? I don't know what you want. Tell me what you want and I'll do it. And then God says, you have to die. Ooh, can we talk about this? When the human body goes into a certain time without water or food, there's a moment before and right after it begins to turn on itself. And it begins to cannibalize itself to survive. I don't mean you physically eating yourself, but it begins to take the muscle and take from it so you'll live. And the flesh fights so hard to live. And it's an animal instinct. You've seen people have been in car accidents or camping accidents. One guy got an arm caught and that kind of stuff. I mean, they live and they go through extraordinary events because they want to live. And this is a gift that God gives to us, but sometimes when God tells you now you got to die to self and the flesh is dying, you think that you've won, but really your flesh is very, very powerful. My flesh, very, very powerful. And so the only thing that can get your flesh under control is his grace. That's it. Only his power can do it. That's addiction. That's mental warfare. You know, it is. Broken heart. Abuse of this world. See, all those things that cut so deep inside of us cannot be fixed. You know, and I don't mind going to counselors and reading books because you have understanding. You can assimilate what you understand. But it's only the power of the cross, his grace, that can actually deliver you and set you free. Amen? And so to close this out, I'm gonna end with that no matter what area you find yourself contending, the purpose of contending, you're going to contend in five areas. You're required to contend in all five areas. God does that because in that wrestling with a strategy, you grow, you mature, and you're transformed, and you're a better person. Amen? The answer to every area of wrestling is His grace is sufficient. And what that means, you're going to engage God, and He's going to train you. Amen? And He's going to train you how to deal with other people and yourself and others. Now, let me give you, I'm going to read off a list of five. And this is my last list of five. These are the five areas for you to invest. So if you have five areas that you're going to contend, I want you to know that contending by itself is not a strategy. I need you to understand there's five areas that you must invest every month in your life. Number one is faith. You have to invest in your life for faith. That means don't think you know everything, and don't think because you've been going to church and holding out a pew for 50 years that you understand faith. Amen? Faith. Secondly is family. And now family is not just blood. It also means those that are close to you. It's relationships that are around you. But you have to invest in family. So you have to learn. Sometimes you have to reconcile relationships that are done. Sometimes you need to release people who hurt you, and maybe they're not even living today. Amen? But there's a lot of baggage and a lot of hurt that comes. So there's a releasing side, but also those that are closest to you, those that you journey with in life, that you are most close to, you need to remember to be grateful for them and to sow in their lives and to speak words of blessing over them, not curses. You know, right? You want to get up, and if you have trouble finding something to be grateful for, and that could be a real problem, then you need to go to God. But at first, be grateful that you're grateful, and then come up with something else later. But family is very important. And one thing about family is that you don't sacrifice family relationships. You don't go to war in your family unless it's just like this is just no other choice. You know, sometimes it just means I'm willing to lose this battle because I just can't live with the consequences of what war would be. It is true. And sometimes it means inside you don't get your way. And at that point, you really have to release it to the Lord and let God work. Amen? Education. You have got to renew your mind. You've got to increase your education. And I don't mean just formalized, I mean otherwise. I read a book a month. Okay? Do it. I can recommend some for you. I'm reading one on ISIS right now. But it's phenomenal. I just read one by Dennis Rosk, Doomed to Succeed. It was about their Israeli, and I love foreign relations, so I'm going to read foreign relations things. I get foreign relations publications, and so I'm going to read foreign policy. But education is very important. I love to rehearse history. I love history. So I'm reading a book right now on the Ottoman Empire called The Endgame. But you know, they're not that. It's not expensive. You need to go to a bookstore at Books a Million. Some people, I don't even know what to read. Figure it out. Don't read what you just want to read. Go get something that invests in you. There's a good book called Outliers. There's a good book that talks about people who are in difficult situations are able to be successful. They're called an outlier. Not everybody is successful. The book Outliers is a good book. Tipping Point, good book about how a business or an individual can come to a place where they can tip and go be successful. And what I'm getting at is not every book that you need to read is the latest, greatest in the church circles. There's more to life. Right? Okay. Not more than your relationship with Jesus, but there's more than church and religion. So I'm not saying just go and just invest all in religion. You have to educate yourself about life. Finances. If you you have to invest in faith, family, education. You have to invest monthly on finances. Figure out ways that you can do better with your money. How to invest it. Look into it. Think about it. If you don't know how to do a business plan, figure out how to do a business plan. Well, because if you don't understand finances, you'll always be working for somebody else, making minimum wage and that kind of stuff, and it's never going to get you anywhere. Figure out how to get a plan, how to get a business plan, how to work, how to partner with people. And then finally is health. You're going to invest in your body. Now, I'll tell you, in these five areas, what I call five pillars, if you will invest in these five areas, it will give back to you. If you do not invest in these areas, you are going to pay a price. Amen? So, and everything I just gave you on the five areas to invest are the five areas that you're going to carry with you every day. So, contend on five grounds and invest in the five areas of faith, family, education, finances, and fitness. Amen? Amen. Well, it has been great to be with you this morning. I pray that this has been a good message for you. And if you'll stand, then I will close it out. You will close it out. I will close it out. Hallelujah. God, your grace is sufficient for me. God, your grace is sufficient for every person in this room this morning. Many of you this morning, you've experienced tragedy this week. And let me say that God's grace is sufficient for you. This morning, some of you are facing financial difficulties. And you're having trouble paying the bills. You're having trouble figuring out what job to take or not take. Maybe you've been unemployed and you don't know where you're going to do next. And I'm going to tell you, God's grace is sufficient for you. Many of you in this room this morning have health problems. And you've come here this day and you say, God, the doctors don't have an answer for me. The medications and treatments are too expensive. I need a miracle in my body. And I say, God's grace is sufficient for you. Some of you in this house are coming here, and it's the holidays and around Christmas, and you grieve because of the hurt and the pain of the past of loved ones that you've lost or you're not in concert with. And there's so much that the holidays used to be such a beautiful thing, but now it is a painful time of year for you. And I say to you this morning, God's grace is sufficient for you. So God, I ask you in this place, Father, and I intercede for every person in this room that has come to this house. And maybe, God, they've been, maybe they're in sin this morning. They've left you, they've backslidden. And I say to you today, God's grace is sufficient for thee. And Lord, today I ask you, Father, to strengthen this church. Strengthen every person in this room, God, that as they contend, they grow. They may victory become so just voracious in this house that they hunger for victory. And not just rehearsing the struggle, but yet embracing the contest. Because your grace is sufficient for the Upper Room Church ministries. God, I ask you this time, Lord, that as this area is being traumatized by economic system, by vandalism, by the world economically is hurting in this region, I ask you, Lord, for miracles to rain down upon your people. Guide them, lead them, open up doors for them, Father, for favor in this area. As a curse of death almost is over this territory, then, Lord, we say life, 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 life. That we will not accept death. We draw a bloodline, Jesus' name, blood of Christ, over your homes in this house. I plead the blood of Christ legally plead his blood over every person in this room and your bloodlines, and I say death shall not come to your house, but it shall pass over. We break every curse that has been spoken against any person in this room or against this church or against this territory or against your bloodlines. Now that means maybe something has happened before you ever came to this church, but it lingers after you from your childhood or even before. And we say today, Jesus, your grace is sufficient. Break the curse. Reverse it, Lord. The same way, God, that you reversed the curse off of Jacob to Israel, then in this house this morning, may the curse be reversed in your life. Hallelujah. Lord, train us. train our hands to go to war, Father, strategically advancing the cause, God. I ask you, Father, to help those that have been fighting in the spirit but haven't been led by your spirit. Convict them, Lord, of where they have used their own emotions to drive them instead of being wholly submitted unto you, God. Because your grace is sufficient, though, for them.